Hi guys, That Song Review Guy here, and here we are, my 100th YouTube video. To tell you the honest truth, I didn't really have anything planned. I was just going to do a normal popular song review. That was until I received this request. And I think you'll admit it's quite a mammoth task. Nevertheless, I took this request and I decided to make a compromise. Instead of giving you guys a huge list of songs that I personally like and that I would recommend only over all sorts of junk that I've reviewed over these last 2.5+ years, I thought I'd give you my top 10 favourite hit singles of 1998. The rules for this is that I've taken every single song that was a top 10 single in the UK in 1998, 194 overall, and I've somehow managed to compress that down to 10 songs. How difficult was it? Well, these songs here were near misses. I'm not expecting any of you to agree with every single song on this list. You might look at this here and think to yourself, well, why isn't that song here? Why isn't that song on it? But 1998, I was a kid back then. I have a lot of guilty pleasures that I just really struggle to keep off the top 10 list. And when I say top 10 list, I'm not saying that these are in any particular order. I'm just going to give you 10 songs that I personally like, that I recommend you guys listen to, and you might not like them. In fact, you may hate all of them. All right, now that that's gone, here we go. These are my 10 favourite hit singles of 1998. Number one, let's start with a classic. No Surprises by Radiohead. Courtesy of the Oxfordshire-based alternative rock group, this is a really very eerie song for me. The electric guitars have a very sort of esoteric effect that really is quite unsettling, and you're not really sure where the song is leading into. And then when it breaks off into the strumming of the acoustic guitars followed by a xylophone of all instruments, it does leave a very bleak feeling that actually really does carry on all throughout, especially in the lyrics, which are equally as bleak. One thing I did notice about this song is that it has a very suicidal undertone, if I can use the word, especially in the lyrics. A handshake of carbon monoxide, such a pretty house, such a pretty garden. From this I get the image in my head that the lead singer Tom York is so broken down by everyday life, he is in such a mindset that he just cannot break away from, and that he sees only one way out, which is, well, suicide basically. The such a pretty house and such a pretty garden bridge, for me, it conjures up an image of possibly heaven. Like, he has succeeded in taking his own life and now he's seeing the gates of heaven right in front of his eyes. I particularly think that Tom York's vocals here are so broken and so fragile in the delivery that it's a song that really does haunt you, and it really does stick with you within the first listen, and you find yourself going back to it over and over again. And for me, it's a true classic. Speaking of classics, the second song on this list is an iconic song and responsible for revitalising this woman's career, and that is Believe by Cher. If you were a kid in the UK towards the back end of 98, this song was pretty much inescapable. You couldn't turn on the radio and not hear it played, and also I think it's a song that really holds up well. It's a very catchy, fun, club friendly and addictive song, and it's not something that is one of these replaceable generic dance songs like a lot of songs you hear on the UK charts now today, especially even in the US. It doesn't feel recyclable, and I think that's what is really special about this song. I particularly like the descending electric guitars throughout the song. It's well known for being one of the first songs to use auto-tune, and I know nowadays auto-tune is abused to death, but it was something that was very different and unique back then, and I think Cher made it work really well. I mean, I love Cher's vocals. I think, you know, as she's got older, her vocals have gotten stronger and more huskier, and I think that they surpass her earlier recordings. These are about Cher leaving her lover and finding self-empowerment, despite the fact that she herself admits that she doubts that she can move on from this person. But the message is such one of hope that you can't help but find it appealing, and that's very, very hard to find in a disco song, to be honest. This song goes way beyond nostalgia, and for me this isn't a case of, oh, I was so nostalgic for this song that I had to put it on this list. I genuinely think that this is a brilliant song, one that really does stand the test of time. Going to the opposite end of the spectrum now, the third song on this list is Thank You by Alanis Morissette. In my opinion, she's an artist that I think everybody should listen to and is easily one of the best female vocalists, I'm just going to put it out there, of all time. It's very, very simple, not only in its lyrics, but also in its instrumentals. It starts off with this electric keyboard with this very simple sort of chord structure, and then introduces drum machines, and also there's a subtle hint of electric guitars in the background. The song, according to Alanis in an interview, is about a spiritual awakening that she had when she was in India. Now, you hear that on the surface, you think to yourself, oh god, here we go. One of these self-indulgent songs, and it's just going to be building up the singer's ego. But you'd be surprised of how simple the lyrics are. Basically, a series of questions that Alanis sort of asks herself and poses also to the listener, and they're not simple sort of questions. They're ones that really do actually make you think, and it does kind of force the listener to take a step back and really listen to what Alanis is asking. I do think this is an incredible song, and one that you should all definitely listen to if you haven't. The fourth song on this list is Teardrop by Massive Attack. Possibly my favourite trip-hop song of all time. It's a very haunting song. It's a very spine-shivering kind of song that's both brittle yet beautiful. The vocals from Elizabeth Fraser are delivered in a very hushed, sort of whispered way. They're not very forceful. There's such a fragileness to them, which goes hand in hand with the instruments so brilliantly. The instrumentation is basically a repeating drum beat, which resembles that of a heartbeat, along with a harpsichord and a lingering piano chords in the background. According to Elizabeth Fraser herself, the lyrics were inspired by the death of her friend, Jeff Buckley. And you can definitely hear that. There's definitely a sense of sadness, love, loss, and even possible death within the lyrics. I think this is such an incredible song that you just sit and you listen and you soak in every single second of the track. And it's one of those where if the second I hear it, you just gotta stop and just gotta soak it all in. It is that brilliant, and it's that powerful of a track. And if you've not heard it, what are you doing? In fact, I urge you to stop this video right here and listen to that song. The fifth song on this list is definitely one from my childhood, and I don't think many people could forgive me for leaving it off the list. It's C'est La Vie by Bewitched. When you put this into context with other songs that have come before this song, and especially some that are going to come after, you might be wondering, why the hell is this on here? Bewitched were an Irish girl group that were very prominent during the 90s. It was actually one of my very first introductions to Irish music, which was very unusual for commercial radio at the time. My first, I think, if I think back, I think the first were The Cause. And they did have some songs that were top 10 singles in 98. But what puts this song on my list over The Cause is just, oh god, it is infectious. It is such a harmless, fun, catchy little tune with such an infectious hook, a great chorus, and such a playfulness to it that it just grows on you and it sticks on you, and you can't even shake it off no matter how hard you try. To younger listeners, it's a very fun, harmless little tune, but as you grow older, you do realise that the song is basically about sex. How they got away with it for so long, much like Frankie Goes to Hollywood did with Relax, I never know. With electric guitars, drums, a bass line, a little violin solo when the chorus comes the second time around, every little intricate piece, and calling C'est La Vie by Bewitched intricate may seem strange, but it is so good, and the only way you can hate this song is if you lack any sort of fun in your life. So let's move the silliness to one side and go back to something a little more serious, and the sixth song on this list is Doo-Wop, That Thing, by Lauryn Hill. One third of the iconic hip-hop trio, the Fugees. This song is a hip-hop slash soul slash R&B track. The lyrics are an empowerment track for women, but it's also a kind of a reality check for men as well. First one centers mainly on women to respect themselves and not chase douchebag men, whilst verse two is solely directed towards the men who are consumed by materialism and flashiness, and using that to come off as this cool sort of swaggerish guy, but also for men to respect women, to realize the rocks that they are, and that, you know, for all the flashiness that they have, they can never replace that of a woman. The soulful piano, the drum track, the horn section, the ascending and descending bass line, couple that with the layered vocals that blend so brilliantly together, it really shows that Lauryn Hill is not only one of the best vocalists there ever been, but as far as the songwriting goes, there is only one Lauryn Hill. You guys all know that my opinion on house music is pretty poor. I do thoroughly believe that it has no place on the UK charts whatsoever, and long gone are the days where you hear good house music anymore. But one exception I can make to house music being on the charts, number 7 on this list, Gangsta Trippin' by Fatboy Slim. Real name Norman Cook, this prominently born mixer, musician and DJ, is one of the most iconic and well-known DJs here in the UK. He's created some of the most well-known house music tracks of the 90s, and choosing any Fatboy Slim song is a real challenge in and of itself, especially during the late 90s, because that's when he's releasing some of his best work. But Gangsta Trippin' edges out Rockefeller Skank by a bare minimum. For me, the horn section at the beginning, the mixing and scratching during the breaks, with an electric guitar screech and a style change-up, a hook that doesn't leave your head, and it's a good kind of never leaves your head. To me, this song is kind of like a multi-layered cake. It just gets better with every single layer that you tuck into. And what more can I say? We gotta kick that gangster shit. This next track is a U2 song, and it is called Sweetest Thing. Now, this song really does stick out like a sore thumb when you compare it to the entire U2 discography. It's very unlike U2, and it's very basic, I think, in its lyrics, but I know there's some sort of charm and whimsicalness to the track that I find very appealing. It's a song, basically, where Bono dedicates it to his wife, Ali Houston. The inspiration came from him missing her birthday because he had to work. An apology song is what it basically is, and the lyrics aren't really that flattering if you really, you know, pick them apart, because in fact it makes Ali Houston look like a bitch, if we're being honest. But I think that it is so smack dizzy in love, and it highlights the toughness of a relationship, that I can't help but be won over by the song. The basic, uncomplicated, sweet yet genuineness that is so unabashed and so heartwarming, along with the sweet staccato piano, picked electric guitar notes, a bass, drums, and the string arrangement is all so simple, but it matches the tone of the song so much. For me, I actually think it's one of U2's best songs. May not be a favourite of like the diehard U2 fan base, and to be honest, I'm not one of them, but it's these kind of songs that I can see the appeal. And if I haven't lost all sorts of respect from you guys after that pick, boy am I gonna lose it here. Dr. Jones by Aqua. Oh, I bet all of you are clicking that cross button right now, but hear me out, okay? Courtesy of the Danish Eurodance Quartet, and responsible for one of the most horrendous songs ever, to follow it up later down the line with this song is kind of fucking brilliant, if you ask me. It seems weird to me that Aqua would release arguably one of the worst songs ever made, and then later down the line would release this as a response. And you say what you want about Aqua, I think this song is pretty fucking perfect as far as Eurodance goes. I mean, Eurodance, you're not expecting anything that's groundbreaking or on the same plinth as, you know, some of the best singer-songwriters out there. And I will admit, this one has some strong nostalgic value, and that's what made it really tough to not put it on this list. But there's such an infectiousness about the hook, and there's something so inescapable about it that it can't help but bring a smile to my face all the time. It opens up with the synth strings, keyboards, and then goes into these sort of fluttering acoustic guitar strings, and of course the techno comes in after the introduction. The lyrics are obviously related to Indiana Jones and is, in a nutshell, a love song. A simple, infectious, catchy song. There's nothing wrong with that, and there's nothing wrong with Dr. Jones. Not the best song ever made, okay? Let's just clear that up. There are leagues of songs that I could list that are better than Dr. Jones. But as I say, you can't help but love an infectious, catchy little ditty. And this is exactly what that is. And the final song that is on this list is You're Still the One by Shania Twain. Probably the signature song from the Canadian country slash pop singer. Inspired by Shania's relationship with her then husband, Zambian born record producer and songwriter Robert Lang, it's about overcoming all sorts of criticisms and negativity that some people may throw at your relationship. It's a song that I find so gorgeous. It's opening up with the soft drums, you're hooked instantly. Piano melody, acoustic guitars and mandolin, the electric guitar and synth strings and keyboard adding a country flair, and with what I think is a lap slide guitar. It's very, very similar to Sweetest Thing in that regards. It doesn't try to be anything more than what it is, and for me it is a perfect example of how to write a brilliant love song. Now, this would be where the video ends right here, but there is a bonus song that I'm going to review, as was requested by the person who suggested this video, and that song is Hands by Jewel. Now, I know Jewel had some decent success in the US, not so much over in the UK. In fact, this song peaked at number 41. It's a soft pop song that's supposed to be inspirational, and it's about not being down by the evils that be. It's a very simple and safe topic to go with, and along with the soft acoustic guitars, piano, drums and the strings in the background, it's definitely a very subtle track. I think the song definitely has some good intentions behind it. Unfortunately though, the song is so boring that I just can't buy into it. It feels so amateurish. The chorus is not imaginative whatsoever, and for me it's kind of pointless. My hands are small, I know, but they're not yours, they're mine alone. Well, no shit, they're your hands. We wake up one morning and be like, these are not my hands. Come on, as a song is just boring, I feel nothing for it. There you go, those are the top 10 hit singles of 1998. But what do you guys think? Do you like these songs? Do you hate them? Do you agree with my opinions? Disagree with them? However you feel, leave your comments in the comment section below. I welcome all of your opinions. I think I'm going to get a lot of disagreements with some of the tracks that I've picked and some of the ones that I didn't, but I encourage you to leave your lists. And until next time, I'm That Song Review Guy. 100 videos, here's to another 100. Thank you once again, and take care.